So we'll go ahead and get started. Sorry, this is the 10th grade, so if you're not in 10th grade, you're in the wrong spot. We'll talk about all things important to sophomores. And I did separate them from the freshmen this year. Last couple years, I've done them together, kind of joint. And while we will talk about and review some of the stuff that we discussed last year, if you came to the freshman event at that time, there is some important stuff that's specific to 10th grade. It's important just to think about them as different students because while they're going through a lot of the same stuff and really thinking about a lot of the same main points about school and college and all that kind of thing, they're usually in a different spot than they were last year. The freshman year is a pretty traumatic year for some, a pretty great year for others. And 10th grade is kind of a transitional year. So we'll kind of go through a lot of that stuff, and I will reference a few of these documents. And there is a sign-in sheet going around, so if you just sign in as well. Just quickly, kind of a brief overview, we'll talk about some common problems that 10th graders typically have. All right, there's some major things that we see consistently for a lot of 10th grade students. So I want to highlight a few of them and a few ways to possibly combat some of the areas of concern. We'll do a brief overview of the A through G requirements. We're not going to go super in-depth, but I do want to talk about that. And that's where we'll talk about this kind of rainbow-colored sheet. And we'll reference that piece of information, but we'll talk to them about all that stuff, and then we'll go over kind of like what a sophomore year looks like in general, and we'll spend a little bit of time, a little bit more than a normal year because there's some big changes happening. Talking particularly about testing, there's a few changes happening, particularly with the SAT program, and your students will all take the PSAT this year, and just bringing you up to date with a few of the changes and things that are going to be different. And then really ending it about what are we going to be doing at home and what should you guys as families be working on getting kind of the conversation going with your students. And then we'll have plenty of time for questions, and we're a small group, so it's really easy for me. If you guys have a question in the middle as we're talking, feel free to just, hopefully not just interrupt, but let me know you have a question and I'd be happy to answer them. Like I said, I don't always have answers. However, if I don't, I'll either take your name and an email or something like that, and I can get back to you after doing a little research or contacting somebody else. But I know most of the questions are fairly routine and repeat, so I can probably answer most of them. Does anybody have any questions that they want to get answered right out the gate, just real quick? I probably will answer them throughout tonight, but just if someone's like chomping at the bit. Okay. So I also want to remind you guys, this presentation should, I'm trying to remember if I uploaded it or not, if not I'll do it right when we're done, a PDF of these slides is available on the website, so this little QR code in that website will take you there, but it's also linked underneath the counseling menu, and it's towards the bottom, and there's like a little pull-out bar, and it says like handbooks, resources, and resource folders, I think is what the title is. This document will be in the grade level resource folders, and what those are shared Dropbox files, or Dropbox folders. If you've ever used Dropbox, it's like a folder on your computer, but living in the cloud. And each grade has their own, and it's something I can keep updated, so as I get more information from colleges, from UC system, from financial aid, I throw that stuff in there for you guys to be able to access. So it's basically a living folder, and things like this file will also be in there for you guys to reference in the future. The video won't be up for probably another two to three weeks. It takes a little bit of time for me to take my computer home so I can use it at work while it processes all the video files, and then I have to upload it to YouTube. So usually takes me about 2 weeks in case you know someone here that is not here and they would like to look at the video to reference later, or if you'd like to go back and watch it again or watch certain pieces as a reminder. And I will send out an email to everybody saying it's up and available when it is. Just a reminder kind of about utilizing services. This is your second year here for most of you guys. A few of it's your first. So I don't want to ignore the newcomers, but I also want to remind those of you that are kind of the old hat now, that I do run my office primarily by appointments. So I really highly prefer when parents and students set up appointments for a couple different reasons. It's not because I want to make your guys' life difficult. It's not because I want you to have to go online to get something set up to come in and talk. It really is because, you know, this year we went from 325 students to 370 students. So I have about 50 extra students on my caseload, and I'm the only person here kind of doing all this stuff. So it helps me balance my time because I want to give my time as equally as I can to all students. not just the ones that can go online and make an appointment. So it also helps me kind of balance my other duties that don't involve sitting with parents and students. So the other reason is it helps me track who I'm meeting with in case we go back and we have questions later, like, oh, did you meet with a student? Yeah, you know, we met on this date and this time. And it also sends you reminder emails saying, hey, your appointment's coming up tomorrow at 11. We'll look forward to seeing you there. So just in case you're kind of forgetful like I am. We do have social media, just in case you guys are on that spectrum of the computer world. And I use it for things like publishing our YouTube videos and getting information out. I send out quick links and updates, reminders about events. We also have a blog. It's not a self-written blog. It's not something that I go and type in every day. But I get kind of a weekly summary of a lot of different great resources and news outlets from a bunch of different things, from financial aid, college, parenting, you know, kind of like depression, suicide, drugs, like how to deal with all these different types of stuff, kind of like all put into one place, and I get a weekly kind of update about that kind of thing. And so I'll copy and paste a bunch of different articles and just throw it in that one location. So you can also sign up to get those via email or like an RSS feed reader, but it's also linked on the website in case you want to access some of that information. And then again, if you have questions, do not hesitate to ask. I'm very happy to answer questions. The only dumb question is the one that's not asked. So if you feel like you have a dumb question, spit it out. I want to hear it. I'd rather have you ask and have that kind of interest quenched than be sitting and wondering and never get it answered. Okay? And I'm sure if you're asking the question, there are probably other people probably in this very room questioning that same thing. Just a quick reminder, I'm not going to go through this because we did cover this last year, but I'm going to highlight two things. One of the parent norms, it's especially gets more important as we're getting older, as our students are getting older, that we are the encouragers and the cheerleaders, not the doers. Okay, I think when students are younger, parents have a much stronger inclination to kind of, oh, well, you're sick, I'll help you do your project, and that kind of thing. Please don't do that for high school students. Okay, it really, really hurts their kind of self-understanding and their growth that they can have access to, and they don't actually learn that much if someone else is doing stuff for them. And that can go from anywhere from doing a project to a homework assignment to even struggling on a math problem. Okay, so you know, you might be good at math and your student might not be yet. Try to have them struggle a little bit. Struggle is okay. Okay, we try to avoid failure. But struggle is where that strength and resilience and persistence comes about. And I don't know about you guys, I've definitely experienced struggle and even failure in our jobs, in our life, in our schooling. And many times that's the stories that we look back on. It's kind of sucky as you're going through it, but that's where you develop a lot of the characteristics and kind of the stuff, the resiliency factors that you need to be successful in life. So having them go through a healthy struggle is okay. I would encourage you to let them do that. Try not to just step in and kind of save, be the rescue life kind of preserver. It feels good sometimes, but it usually causes more harm than good. And then if we had students here, I would basically remind them that they are the ones ultimately responsible for their learning. Okay, none of us, none of you as parents, none of us as school staff, none of their peers can make a student learn. Sometimes we wish we could. Sometimes we wish we could just put their butts in a seat and push a button and they're automatically in learning mode. Unfortunately, that's not how kids work. And so ultimately, kind of the idea that we try to ingrain in them as they go through 9th and 10th grade, because hopefully they get it by 11th and 12th. Most do. Some are still lagging a little bit, but most will figure it out by 11th and 12th. But as I'll talk about in a minute, there are some major concerns that students have and get themselves into during that 9th and 10th grade year that are sometimes non-fixable. Okay, so they can dig themselves pretty deep holes, and it's really challenging to get out of those. So that's just one thing that, you know, I try to encourage students, that responsibility factor of you are ultimately the person that's in charge of your own learning. Your teachers are supposed to teach you, but you're part of that equation too. And so if you're not kind of plugging in as that factor in that equation, it doesn't matter how hard that teacher works or how hard that teacher teaches or all the different strategies they use, learning's not going to happen. So that's one thing that we try to instill in the students. Some common problems, and I'm just so you guys know, time-wise, I'm looking at probably an hour tonight. Most of these things, other grades, typically are about an hour and a half. This one's a little bit of review, so it'll take hopefully a little bit less time. I'm happy to stay as long as you guys have questions or want to get more information, but just to give you guys a timeline in case you guys are thinking dinner or picking up kids up for practice or whatever it might be. So transitioning into some issues that we see sophomores typically make. And these are pretty common. Okay, it can happen to a 4.0 student and it can happen to a 1.0 student. Okay, there's, you know, grades don't necessarily predict problems. Sometimes they're correlated a little more, but a student that's a very successful, very popular student can have just as many or more of these problems come up in their 10th grade year, just as a student who's maybe struggling and maybe not academically focused or dealing with other issues going on in their lives. Okay, so I just don't try not to compartmentalize your student into like a certain group, because things happen for a lot of kids and we want to be prepared in case they do. A few of the big ones, and most of them are academic, just so you know, most students don't struggle tons socially. You know, if you think back, you see like the horror stories and TV shows about high school, and everyone that you ask says my high school years were horrible. However, most students, that's usually not the story. That's usually not their kind of experience. But what they end up doing is they're going through a time in their life where there's a couple like developmental as well as physiological factors that are affecting their thinking and their decision-making process. And so many times a sophomore who's kind of in that 15 turning 16 age range, starting to look at getting a license, starting to look at some big responsibility steps, they have to think, they want to be treated like an adult. I don't know if you've experienced that with your kid or not, but they want that kind of respect and that experience of, talk to me like I'm an adult, talk to me like I'm a peer, not your child. However, they don't have the decision-making processes to make decisions like an adult. So, I mean, there's actually literally a physiological issue with students' brains. Until they're about 25, like, they don't have enough brain in their prefrontal cortex to actually make good decisions. They get really bogged down in thinking far enough in advance in terms of consequences, in terms of results, that they'll think of, okay, this is going to feel good for the next 30 seconds, or this is going to be fun for the next, you know, 2 minutes. But they won't think of, okay, 9 years down the road, or 9 months down the road, this might not feel so good. 10 minutes down the road, this might hurt a lot. 4 years down the road, this might affect my college entrance chances. Okay, so there's literally something wrong with their brains. And it doesn't go away when they're 18. It's like 25 is usually kind of right around when that brain kind of finally settles down. But it does get better as they get older. One thing that they don't seek out, though, when they're looking at these decision-making processes is kind of the information and research to back up what they're going to do. I want to drop chemistry. Okay, why? Because I don't like the teacher. Or my friends aren't taking chemistry, or whatever like these short-term things are, but they don't see how, well, did you know that you need chemistry to graduate? Did you know that you need chemistry or physical science to get into college? Well, do you want to go to college? Not really right now. And then 2 years later, they come back to me and they now want to go to Harvard. Okay, so the decision, like where they're at is in kind of this weird fluctual place, okay? Many times they also prioritize their social aspect and their social life over their academics. I can also substitute social with sports, okay? And I will talk a little about sports and kind of priorities and that kind of thing. Please don't hear me wrong and hear me say that I don't like sports and that we don't support sports and that sports are not important. Sports are highly important to the school. Sports are highly important to students, to colleges, to their enjoyment of their school experience. However, sometimes they get placed at the pedestal of what a student is here for. And, I always like to say it's called being a student athlete for a purpose. The order is very important. It's not an athlete student. They're not a professional athlete, they're a professional student. But primarily we see social aspects coming into play for the 10th graders. You might have experienced some of that in 9th grade as well. They have a lot of these weird social, you know, their friend circle changes quite a bit. There's a lot of drama and crying sometimes, and girlfriends dumping boyfriends, and all of a sudden getting back together. And it's a lot of that in 9th and 10th grade. So it's not going away quite yet. And it does get a little bit better in 11th and 12th because, you know, they grow up. They start becoming more mature young people. And there's not as much, like meaningless, like, drama. It's more like kind of serious drama sometimes, if there is drama. But they do put that academic second many times, and that's where they start getting themselves in holes. They are typically right now, I call it the sophomore summer, and we see it every year, and I'm not the only one that sees this. You know, Ms. Padilla, Ms. Mitchell, and many other people around the United States and the world kind of see this, that developmental change, and we call it the sophomore summer, because it's like when kids leave their sophomore years, they're these like crazy kids that don't have any purpose in life. They don't really know what they're doing. They're not really super driven. And then something weird happens over the summer. Well, I don't know if they get a job. I don't know if it's kind of, it's just weird. I don't know if they drink some weird Kool-Aid, but many times they probably do. But they come back as juniors, and it's like a light switch was turned on. It's pretty amazing. And it's, again, it's not for everybody. So if your student is not that student, it's okay. That doesn't mean there's something wrong with them. But that's just the majority of students that we see. They come back and they're totally different students. They now have connected what they're doing in high school to what they're going to do next, it seems like. That's the biggest change that we see. They see why they're here. They see what they're doing at school as now more important. It's not their favorite thing that they get to do every day, but they now understand a little bit more about why they come to school and how that will pay off in the future. I don't know if that's some of the brain development. I don't know. There's no research backing up that I've found, but it's pretty consistent. 10th grade to 11th grade, there's a big change in personality and kind of school focus. So I want to just give you guys that encouragement. But this is still a year that they can't see that yet. So that's something that we as educators and you as parents have to be really vigilant about, because those are conversations that you need to be having with them. You guys are a part of that equation. Okay? If you haven't been talking to your kids about what's going to happen after high school, you should. Okay? It's not something that you have to be an expert in. Okay? You don't have to have some sort of degree in college advising. You don't have to have a complete understanding of the FAFSA. You don't have to understand all, you know all 6,000 plus universities in the United States. Okay? That's not a requirement. The requirement is just asking questions. It's just, okay, talk to me about like what you're thinking. Like, one of my big suggestions is, dads, if you got a daughter, take your daughter out on a date night once a month. Talk about college. Talk about stuff that they're interested in. Find out more about them as a student and as a person, and that's going to guide them into thinking about what they want to do next. You can obviously slip some of those pointed questions in the conversation, and that does a couple things. It not only helps them think about after high school, it also probably will help any parent and child relationship. And you get to know your son or daughter even more. Take them out to ice cream. Take them out to mini golf or skiing or whatever it might be. Just spend some time, but have kind of a purpose. Don't just go to get ice cream. I like ice cream too, but go with kind of like a goal in mind, and eventually work yourself around to reaching that goal of, all right, well, let's, you know, we got to talk about your boyfriend or whatever, and whatever else is going on in their life that they really are excited about. Let's talk about, like, okay, what's going to happen when you guys go to college? What's going to, you know, have you thought about what your interests are? Just little questions, very open-ended, let them answer. Okay, and it might take practice, it might take time, but that's one thing that parents can do that's really helpful. So some pitfalls. So we talk about common problems, and that's going to segue us into talking about these kind of big holes that people can get into. And just so you know, when we analyze our student information at the end of each year, when we look at our graduating seniors, we do send a lot of kids off to college. And the ones that really struggle with kind of being ready, they're not taking the wrong classes. So all students pretty much take the right classes. The issue that students find themselves in that really preclude them from possibly applying to a four-year school when maybe they are, you know, they want to as a junior and senior and they're probably ready to, is 9th and 10th grade grades. Okay, so when we go through the A through G lists, and I'll talk about the grade requirement for that right now, it's really important to remember or realize that to get into those four-year colleges, and the A through G is specific to the UC, University of California, and the CSU, the 8 UCs and the 23 CSUs, and essentially when students are taking these classes, there's a certain number of classes, and we'll go through them, but they have to get a C or better in those classes for them to count. So when a student, for example, takes English 9, which is a requirement to be even have the privilege of submitting your application to these schools, not doesn't make you like competitive, it just makes you eligible. That student, if they get a D in English 9 without repeating that class, they are not even eligible of submitting that information to schools. Okay, there are some very minimum requirements. So that's the biggest things that we see when we look backwards. Why are students not meeting their ATG requirements? It's typically D's or F's in 9th and 10th grade, and typically English, math, or science. That's usually the big three in those 2 years. Okay, and many times the students that are kind of in that boat, on that kind of fine line, there's obviously some students that are like totally on the other side of the line that are really struggling with school, but for the students that are kind of right in that they could have been eligible group, it's those classes, and it's usually like one or two D's. And those students usually pick up their pace and pick up their performance after 9th and 10th grade year, and they're taking AP courses and getting A's. And, you know, we try to get them to repeat, or we try to get them to do that, and until they do, they won't even be eligible. And that's pretty applicable to most colleges you look at. That doesn't include things like two-year community college or junior colleges. Those don't have that grade requirement. It's typically your four-year college and university experience that you're looking at, that C or better. And C minus does count, just so you know. A lot of times people also focus a lot of effort and energy on what's going to happen in two or three years. You know, they spend a lot of money traveling around looking at schools. They spend a lot of time talking about college, and that's great. Don't get me wrong. That is an awesome thing, and I highly recommend doing that. However, sometimes people ignore what they're doing right now to focus on that. So they'll stop talking about, well, tell me about your English 10 class that you're in right now. How's that going? Are you doing your homework? And one thing that I'll talk about real quick that can help you guys, and there's two handouts that we'll mention, is we have a program called 1-2. Okay, and this is a school-wide expectation. It's actually tied to our school-wide goals. And there are some handouts over here. There should be plenty. You don't have to get up and get them right now, but we're not going to read through this. I'll just kind of talk briefly, but if you want to pick them up later, it's great. There's two handouts. This one, it's a double stapled sheet. It's a little less pretty, more academic. This is for teachers and parents. Okay, so that's what I created this for. It's a little bit more in-depth, a little bit more like cut and dry. This one here is designed more, mainly for students. It's a little more flashy and cool, and kind of gets to the point and kind of delivers in a more teen-friendly way. But the nuts and bolts of that is there's a lot of research out there about studying and the amount of time students spend in their content. And at the top of one of these, you'll see that it says the average high school student across the nation studies about 19 minutes a night. Okay, and that's average. That means there are plenty of students that study more than that. However, there are plenty of students that study less than that. Okay, and I can probably think of a few students, possibly whose parents are here today, that probably study less than that. Okay, I'm not pointing anybody out, and if that's not true, but you can probably think about your own child, and it's likely there are several of them. Okay, and I'm not saying that's wrong. Okay, so don't hear me say like you're a bad parent, they're a bad student. That's not what I'm saying. My focus is they could be better. Okay, they could be doing more. They could be achieving greater things if they spent the time. And it's just like, I liken it to working out. It's just like going to the gym or starting a new sports team. It's going to be horrible for the first little bit. You know, you all have probably started gyms and stopped gyms and started gyms and stopped gyms. You know, when you go back, you're like excited for like a day. You're like, yeah, I'm gonna run every day, and you get home, and the next day you're sore. You're kind of bummed out, and you kind of drag your butt to the gym, and maybe do it for another couple of days, and then you're over it. You get sick, or you're just too sore, you can't handle it. Something else comes up, and it's a different priority. Same thing happens to student study. I mean, if you remember studying, or if you have that kind of like impact in your work environment. Studying can be very mental. It's mentally draining. It's exhausting for students. And they're already here 6.5 hours a day. Trust me, we get that. However, there's a lot of research and a lot of information out there that talks about how it is very important for students to practice the skill. And I can tell you from personal experience, high school was really easy for me. High school was a breeze. I didn't spend a lot of time doing studying, as people would call studying. You know, I would do my homework. Probably like many students here, I would do it at school, or, you know, it might take me 10 minutes at home if I started at school. And I was in plenty of AP classes, and, you know, I was a valedictorian in high school. And then I went to college, okay? And college is a totally different world, because in college, you know, in high school you're spending 6.5 hours a day in class, and then you go home and do your homework for a little bit of time. In college, you might spend maybe an hour, maybe none on Tuesdays or something like that, or, you know, you're spending probably about 10 hours, 10 to 12 hours a week versus like 30 hours a week in class actually learning. The rest of it is actually happens outside of school. So part of this is actually adapted from a program that I learned about when I was at Cal Poly. I think they still do it, called the 25 to 35. Okay, and that's totally unreasonable for high school students, so we adapted it to be a little more digestible and appropriate. However, it's a research-backed program that one of the greatest universities in the CSU system and much of the United States really banked a lot of their effort and time on. But the idea with the 1 to 2 is that students should be spending at minimum 1 hour every single day of the week. I'm not talking weekends. Weekends are free. I'm not worried about weekends. But every day of the week, spending 1 to 2 hours studying. And when I say studying, many parents and students will think homework, which is a part of studying, but it is not solely studying on its own. Studying is homework, so if they have homework, they should definitely be doing their homework. But many students, I'll talk to your parents, come in, my kid comes home and they tell me I finished my homework at school. Great, they worked hard at school, maybe they had a little extra time, they focused, they got some stuff done. I can tell you, one, that's a good sign. However, that's not going to be a fact after this year for sure for most of your students. I was walking by a student and we were talking, and I actually overheard him talking to another teacher. Didn't know I was listening, and he was saying, yeah, last year I think I studied like 10 minutes a night. This year it's like an hour and a half. Like, and this is a 10th grader to 11th grader. Okay, so it blows up big time. And so just like with the gym approach, you have to practice this. It's not something that you can learn immediately. So that's one of the pieces here. If they don't study an hour every night, but they study 45 minutes a night, guess what? That's progress. If that's more than what they were doing before, that's what we're looking for. So they can do things like do their homework. They can do things like reviewing chapters. They can go into their textbook. They can go onto Khan Academy and practice their math. Teachers are also going to be developing over the next couple months a series of kind of general lists for each of their classes for 1 to 2 activities that they can do specific to chemistry or specific to English 10, that kind of thing. In the next couple weeks as well, you're also going to be getting a commitment form that this is something that we're starting just to kind of like essentially send home, because we can't do this by ourselves at school. It's a whole village approach. So basically it's a commitment just reminding you guys about this, but also saying, you know, from a student commitment and a family commitment, you know, we're willing to, you know, the student's saying I'm willing to make sure that I'm doing some of these activities every night for an hour. And from a family perspective, saying we're supporting this and we're going to make time that this happens, and this is a priority for our family. So that's something you can agree or not agree. I'm not forcing you guys to do this. I think it's a really good idea, and I hope you guys will. But that's something that's coming down the road. So, you know, other things they can do. They can read. I mean, reading is an academic activity. They can research colleges and careers. There's tons of websites. If they're on the web, you know, get them off YouTube, get them on Naviance, get them on College Board. Have them spend a little bit of time researching that stuff. I work with tons and tons of seniors who wait to the last minute and then are completely stressed and completely overwhelmed because they didn't put in the time up front. And so by kind of loading them with some of this research activity, it gets their brain thinking, but it also takes some weight off that senior year, which is already a busy year as it is. So anything we can do ahead of time and take some of that work and transfer it to an earlier year will be super helpful to their mental well-being. I promise you that. The last thing is working hard. I showed all the 10th graders a video about choice and about a line. I probably should have showed you guys. It probably would have been good for you guys to see too. It's a good reminder. I enjoyed it. It was a good reminder for me. And it basically talks about a line, and I'll just summarize it. It talks about a line, and on one side of the line, there's people and decisions that are just mediocre. There are people and decisions that don't lead to greatness. Okay, they kind of settle, essentially. On the other side of the line, there are people that try, that work hard, that have the intent to succeed and will not stop for anything less. And it compares, like, you know, Steve Jobs and Bill Gates and Drew Brees and, you know, Venus Williams and all these people that are famous. And you know, you think about all these people that these students look up to, whether it's a rapper or, you know, a musician or an athlete, or you guys, that might be wishing for too much, but whoever they look up to, most of the time those people are highly successful in their field. You're not going to look up to some probably average Joe. And at least as a high school teenager, some people in their work environment do. But most of these people are very famous for being highly successful. And one thing that the kids don't necessarily think about is how many of those people that are highly successful did the bare minimum to get there? Probably none of them. They worked extra hard. They put in tons and tons of time. If you've ever read the book 10,000 Hours or whatever it's called, it's that concept. It's going to take you a lot of time, sometimes blood, sometimes sweat, sometimes tears, to be successful. Same thing applies for being a student. You know, that intent to succeed in surrounding yourself by the right people is also super crucial. And that goes into play with that socializing aspect of who is your student surrounding themselves with. I'm not telling you, please don't go home and like force them to hang out with certain people, but have that. That's another conversation that you can have on that date night or on that road trip of, okay, talk to me about your friends. Like, what are your friends influencing you like? Okay, those are all important things because that will change their approach to school and life. All right, so please do not slam the doors to success, okay? And that's, again, talking about those grades. That's talking about students making decisions as that uninformed 10th grader that I'm not going to college. I'm not college material. I am too stupid. I don't have the grades already, okay? By a student or a family member or even a school person telling the student no, at a point there will be possibilities that no come around. They don't meet certain requirements, there's not an option for you in this route. Okay, but as a 10th grader, most students should have almost every opportunity still open to them. Okay, but when they start slamming doors, they start taking themselves out of opportunities and options. Okay, so having that open conversation about what is important to you and listening to what your student says. Okay, many parents, myself included, I have expectations that many students should go to four-year college. Okay, not every student should though. I'm under firm belief that four-year college is not for every student, even if your student is a 4.0 student. Okay, there's a lot of factors that have to come into play for a student to fit at a certain university. Some students are better fit at a trade school. Some students are better fit at a community college for a lot of different reasons. So having that conversation and saying, we think that this is probably the best fit, but we're open to having conversations about whatever you think about yourself. Because ultimately, they're the experts in themselves. And while we many times marginalize kind of what a 15, 16-year-old says, they know more, and they're more insightful than we give them credit for a lot of times. They know what's going on within their learning, within themselves, within their motivational factors. So listening to what they have to say, that doesn't mean that they get to drive the entire ship the entire time. You have some input. However, they also should. So if you guys are strictly saying, no, you're going to four-year school and you're going to Berkeley or something like that, that's something maybe you should rethink. Excuse me, I'm going to get a drink of water. So quickly, we're going to work through this pretty quick, and I'm happy to answer questions through this because there's usually questions that come up. And let me just stop. Is there any questions about what we've gone through so far that you guys want to ask? Again, please ask questions as we go through. You don't have to wait till the end. You can, but questions, happy to answer them as we go through. Yes?
If a student got a D, can they go to summer school and fix it, or do they have to do it on top of their other load the next year?
So there's a couple different things about deficient grades. Deficient grades would be what we call a D or an F, typically. For graduation purposes, a D does count. Okay. For that college purposes, they don't. And for college purposes, in certain classes, they don't. They won't, like, really, in these classes, they won't count. If they got it in another class, it's not going to prevent them from going to college, so they got it in culinary or in engineering or something like that, which is not an A through G required class. It's typically going to be for things like that. But however, to answer your question, if a student does get a deficient grade, say if they got an F in a required course, they're going to have to repeat it because it's probably tied to a graduation requirement as well. F gets no credits. So if they got an F in English 9, for example, for the first semester, they're going to be repeating English 9 at some point. It might not be the next year, depending on what they're taking. We don't have summer school, so summer school is not an option. And I just want to clarify, too, there's not a way to replace a grade. So replacing a grade doesn't happen. You can retake a class for an improved grade with a D or an F, However, the DRF stays. It does not go away. However, in purposes for college applications, if you got a D or an F, for GPA calculations, that GPA does not, the original F or D GPA is not calculated. However, you still report it, but it also is not used to meet your minimum requirements. So does that answer the question? So like they would typically, it depends, there's a lot of variables about when they would take it, where they would be able to take it. Most students, you know, depends if they only need a semester or a full year. A lot of different things. Many times we'll use Coldstream, which is an independent study school, to make up partial credits of failed classes. The only downside is they would not be able to take a full six classes. They have to have a period to meet with that teacher. So it will affect the classes they can take in the future if you have to repeat courses. Any other questions? That was a good question.
What if a student has a, it's not a F, but a D or C, and he wants to improve the grade?
My first question would be why. Not necessarily like why do you want to improve that, but what is your motivation to improving it? Like what is your goal with improving? Is it to strictly improve your GPA? Is it because you got a D in English and you're not eligible and you want to become eligible? There's a lot of questions I would probably ask. So for college, they can only repeat D's or F's. So like C's and above, they can't repeat. Say a student gets a B, they really want an A, they can't repeat that. And so essentially that's kind of where it's cut off. However, for purposes of like the CSU or UC, say they want to improve their GPA, they could repeat like a failed English class. I just use English as an example. From 9th grade in the 11th grade year or something like that, and get a better grade, the grade doesn't go away. However, like I said, the GPA would change. It will not change a lot. Okay, so I'll tell you that. It's not going to change significantly. Having two extra points spread out through all of their GPA, and we'll talk a little bit about GPA in a little bit. I'll kind of give you some examples of all the different types and a little bit about how it's calculated and what the big factors are. But it won't change, like repeating a C to a B or an A is not going to drastically change a GPA. So that might be a question that we talk about afterwards if you have a specific example that you're thinking about, like with your child. But there's a lot of different things that we'd have to talk about why and if it's possible and what the purpose is and if it's going to be helpful if they want to repeat it or not. Some things it's not really helpful for them to repeat. And I would say just take a different class and get a good grade in that class. But good question. Is that a good answer enough that we can talk later? Okay. Any other questions before we jump into this? Okay, I want to make sure we keep moving. So this is the A through G, but this sheet here also includes on the far left, it's got our high school graduation requirements. You'll see two-year college requirements, and if you pay close attention, it's exactly the same. Okay, I just put that on because I want to include the system. However, they don't have an entrance requirement. It's all the same. Basically, they need to graduate high school to be eligible to enroll in a community college. Okay, but I wanted to make sure people saw that, because it is something that is a very viable option and an awesome option for many students. On the far right, there's two columns, the CSU and the UC, and they vary slightly. They're usually about the same. And I'll denote through this quickly when we hit some major differences. And most of the time, they are made up for because they're in part of our graduation requirement. It's not even it's basically not an issue, usually, the difference between them. So the A through G, they're all letters that have a category of their subject, so they're technically called the minimum subject requirements for admissions to this CSU and UC system. The A part is history, and this one's easy. Okay, the biggest, again, when I say it's easy, that doesn't mean it's easy, but it's part of their graduation requirements. If they don't pass these classes, they won't graduate high school, which then college goes out the door. So by taking these classes, all students in 10th grade are going to take Modern World History, all students in 11th grade are going to take U.S. History, and all students in 12th grade are going to take government. Econ is a part of that government class, but that doesn't show up in this A category. That's actually a G category class, and they're two semester long classes that are put together. They don't change teachers, they don't change classrooms, it just changes subjects at the halfway point through the semester. So the big thing here, again, that screws people up is getting that D. They start getting D's in any of these classes, that's when they are still meeting graduation kind of progress, they're not meeting these college progress, okay? There are the AP classes as well. So, and I'll just if I say any acronyms that you guys don't understand, sometimes my brain doesn't catch that. Just ask, what does AP mean, or what does whatever this other acronym means? So AP stands for Advanced Placement, and Advanced Placement are essentially college-type classes. They're essentially college level. I say essentially because they're not, like, they don't receive college credit just for taking the class. They have to pass a test and prove that they're proficient in that content. But they do get those are classes, and that's how people will get a 4.2 GPA. They have a weighted GPA. So they're rewarded for taking a more challenging course with a slightly elevated GPA. If a student got all A's and never took an AP course, for example, the highest GPA they can ever get is a 4.0. There's no way they can get higher than that. With a AP coursework included in their classes, they can get above a 4.0, so 4.2, 4.1, 4.22. And that's kind of what that is, and there are big cumulative capstone exams that happen at the end of the school year in the first 2 weeks of May for each AP course that we have. We don't require students to take it, but we highly encourage it if they do pretty well in the class. All right, English, B. 4 years are required. Again, fairly easy, because we also require 4 years of English at the high school. Okay, so the big thing here as well, D's really screw kids up in terms of being ready for this four-year college experience. Again, if they got a D, they can still graduate, they can still enroll in community college, they won't be eligible to apply to almost all four-year, many four-year schools. I won't say all, there are some out there that will take a D, but it's pretty golden standard what they have here in California. And again, the English 9, kind of standard English 9, 10, 11, 12 track counts, as well as the Honors English and the AP English class. And we do allow students to go back and forth. So if a student's not in honors as a 10th grader, they can go to AP. I would highly suggest that the student talks to a teacher about that move. There is summer assignments that they have to be aware of for AP work. So it's highly encouraged that the student has a conversation, and you as a parent probably have a conversation about that move. But if they're ready, I highly encourage you guys to do that. Like, the design of the course is a very challenging course, but it's gonna push them. And if they're ready for it, it's gonna help their academics and their seeking of knowledge. C, math, and this is where it kind of starts getting a little confusing for people, and sometimes it's confusing for me to explain, so I'll do my best. The basics of it is this. Students need 3 years of math for that CSU-UC requirement. They also need 30 credits of math to graduate. However, there are different classes that are required. Okay, all students, every single one of them, whether they graduate high school or go on to college, are going to need Integrated 1 or Algebra 1, depending on kind of where you're at. Most students here are going to be in Integrated Math approach. Integrated Math 2 or Geometry. And then for graduation, they need one more math class for 30 credits. That could be Integrated Math 3 or Algebra 2, or it could be our Business Math class. So Business Math class is a non-college prep class, but still meets graduation requirements. It's actually a very good class, but it's not going to be kind of pushing us towards that kind of entrance college prep type content. Most students, if you're looking at that four-year college route, and even students that are even decent at math and are thinking about enrolling in a community college or pursuing some type of education, at all levels they're going to be placement exams, and most of those placement exams are going to be at the Algebra 2 level. Okay, so at least getting through Algebra 2 for most students is what I highly suggest, unless there's very good reasoning why they won't be successful there and it will affect their graduation, for example. However, there is additional coursework that's suggested beyond that. Basically, if you're looking at, like, and I was just out yesterday at a UC conference at Davis, and all the admissions directors come and talk to all of us. We get updates. They go through case studies of how they review applications and what they're looking for. It's a really great day. But the reason I mention that is because I have the freshest data I can tell you. And I can tell you, they literally told us UCLA, Berkeley, and UC San Diego is kind of on the line. But those two schools, if you're looking at UCLA and Berkeley, if you don't have calculus on your transcript, if you don't get up to that level, say you start off at pre-calculus or even Algebra 2, the likelihood of you getting in it is almost none. Okay, it's that competitive. The UC system in overall had about a 53% acceptance rate. However, it's highly skewed. UC Merced accepted about 65% of students, where UCLA and Berkeley were more towards the 15 to 20%. Okay, so that's all.
If you're going to school and you're not planning on doing a science, They still want you to have calculus?
At those two schools, yes.
All right.
Unless, so the other option might be, so the only other option would be if like you go through pre-calculus and it's like, this is not my language, I cannot, like, I will not be successful at all in calculus. It would be a much better option for them to take, if they were knew they were not going to be successful or had a very strong inclination, to take an online statistics class or possibly statistics through the college as kind of a substitute, but they should not omit that kind of high-level math class. So that would be much, they would have a much better shot of getting in with that stats class versus not having that kind of high-level math class at all. Does that answer the question? But yeah, there are some students that it's not super important that they take calculus. However, at some schools, because they're not only competing against our students here, they're competing, I mean, there was 80,000 people that applied to Berkeley last year. And they're not all 80,000, you know, 2.0 students that get through algebra 2 barely. Like, people that applied to Berkeley are all, like, they showed us their GPAs from the admissions class, and, like, I want to say Berkeley's mean GPA was 4.0. Okay, and their low was like a 3.6. So it's the type of thing that they're competing against everybody else who's just as competitive. So it basically becomes, and it doesn't really help, like, they do a holistic review as well, which we'll talk about briefly in a little bit, but essentially trying to kind of wrap up and answer the question as best I can, it's highly important that they do as much as they can to be competitive. Because if they're looking at these highly competitive schools, they're looking at less competitive schools or like CSU schools that are a little bit less competitive, it's not as crucial. But particularly with things like, you know, Stanford, Harvard, all those schools that are like top, anything probably above that 20% admissions rate, that's so competitive that omitting that class basically takes you almost out of the running, because everybody else has that and everything else that you probably have too, and great essays and great test scores. So it's really, it becomes kind of like, we can compare apples to apples, but the student doesn't have this, so they're now an orange, and we're getting rid of the oranges. So I know that doesn't probably totally answer the question. That's the best I can do right now. But we can talk later if you want. Yeah?
As a kid in integrated 2 at this point, can they end up taking calculus 5?
So that's a question that I get every time, and I'll do my best to answer that one as well. The answer is yes, but it's not easy. Okay, so the question is, if you couldn't hear, the question was, if a student comes in at Integrated Math 1 as a freshman and are now in Integrated Math 2, can they get through calculus? On our system, no. Okay, if they took one math class every single year, no, they cannot. They will not be able to get through integrated, they'll get to pre-calculus as a senior, because they take one math class a year for 4 years, that's the fourth math class down that kind of system. However, for students that it's highly important to them to get into these high-level colleges or take a, you know, much more advanced math class like calculus or a statistics class or something like that, that kind of shows their competitive nature and their competitiveness, what we're suggesting students do, and it's not something I wish on any student, trust me, but essentially they will need to take an online math class over a summer. And that's pretty much the only way to kind of bypass that class and kind of get to that calculus or kind of fifth, quote-unquote, fifth-year math. And that really is fifth year. So pre-calculus is a fourth-year math, which is what they recommend. However, when you're looking at those highly selective colleges, and that's like those two of those eight UCs, probably one or two of the CSUs, all of the Ivies, but the other ones that are highly selective around the country, unless we're talking about those, they will likely be okay with pre-calculus. So it's not something that every student has to, unless that is their like dead-on goal, and they are in that kind of realm already. If they're a 3.2 student, don't push them to take an online math class to get ready for Berkeley. Likelihood of them getting in is not good anyways. So, you know, it's going to be a REACH school as it is, so it might put too much stress and pressure, and they might not. It might blow all their other classes. Which is a factor we have to consider. Like, is this class going to put too much weight and emphasis on this class only, and this is what's going to consume your life, and it's going to affect your English class and your history class and everything else. So it's really kind of depends on where your student's at, what their goal is, and then kind of how realistic, I guess, would it be for that student to, you know, need that to absolutely be admitted somewhere that's really selective. So that's my best answer I can give you.
What class is that?
What?
you said the online math.
It depends. There's a lot of different stuff online available. It would be a person-by-person basis. There's different costs. There are different timings. There are certain classes, just so you know, you can't just sign up on your own and just bring a transcript to us. There's a process. We pre-approve all outside courses that are not offered through our school district. So anything that's not pre-approved, if you complete it online or through a different school and we didn't get pre-approval, we will not honor the credit, just so you guys know. So it's very important that you guys communicate if that is where you're at and you want to look at doing online coursework. We definitely can accommodate most of it. However, it's something that we do need to look at before and pre-approve it. So I'm going to move us on so we can keep going. Still trying to get us out of here without taking too long. But math, with a D in math, and this might open a can of worms, so not sure if I actually want to say it or not. There are, with math and Spanish / foreign language, there are ways to what they call validate deficient grades. Okay, so D in Algebra 1 can be validated by a C or better in Algebra 2. Same thing with like a D in Spanish 1 can be validated, meaning that requirements method grade doesn't go away. It's still used in GPA. However, it can be, you can still be eligible with a D in Spanish 1 and a C in Spanish 2, for example. It's proving, those two categories prove that you know the prior material to be successful in the next level of math. There are some very specific things, so don't just take that at face value. Oh, I'm fine. With that D, it's very specific of what counts where and that kind of thing. So if that's you, we need to talk about it because I'll have to make sure we know what we're talking about. But just want to throw that there, like a D cannot necessarily ruin this if that's the case. Like if you have a D in Algebra 1, you're not out of the boat. Lab science, I highlight lab or laboratory science. It does have to have a wet lab component, which is why you'll probably never find an online science class that we will take. So you need 2 years of lab science, which is nice because you need 2 years of lab science to graduate from our high school as well. You need a biological and a physical science. Chemistry, physics are going to be your physical science that most students are taking this year. And then biology, almost all freshmen took it last year. Again, C or better. If you didn't do that, you have opportunities to take additional science classes in the future that can fill these requirements. So if you got a D in biology, you can take anatomy physiology as a junior, and guess what? You pass that class, you're good to go. Okay. Again, these are minimum requirements. When we talk minimum, you can now submit. Doesn't mean you're necessarily competitive. Okay, those are two different things. And again, there also is an AP chemistry class. The one thing I will say about sciences, as we hit the spring and we start looking at course requests, we cannot offer all these classes every year, just so you guys know. We have been able to recently because of some of our staffing and how we've made it work, but that's not likely to be every year. So there will be times when we have to say, well, there's two kids that signed up for AP chemistry. Unfortunately, your kid was one of them. We're not going to offer that class. What's your next best option? Okay. But we do throw it out there to be selected with all the other courses, and we'll take whatever we can make work. Language other than English. Unfortunately, fortunately for us, we offer Spanish. Unfortunately, it's the only language you offer in case you were wanting other ones. However, it is the most relevant and important language that I think a student can learn unless they're going to be living in a foreign language that speak, or another country that speaks that language. Living in California, even in the United States, Spanish is a very, very highly valuable tool for students to learn how to speak. I wish that I would have paid more attention in my Spanish classes. I took 2 years of Spanish, and I understand a lot more than I can speak, but it's something that I need to go back and go back to school and learn some additional Spanish. So it's a highly relevant skill for all students, I believe. Any questions about foreign language? 2 years are required, and they do have to be subsequent years, so you can't take French 1 and Spanish 1. It has to be French 1 and 2, Spanish 1 and 2, and so on and so forth. This is where our graduation requirements also differ. For graduation purposes, a student will need either a fine art or a foreign language. For college purposes, for the four-year colleges, they need that 2 years of a foreign language and 1 year of fine art. Okay.
So I have a question. So if like Spanish 2 doesn't seem to be working out, like we're very early in the year, like when is it too late to be like, well, we should probably go back to Spanish 1 and substitute another class?
So yes, our ad drop period is over. So basically from Friday was our closing date. From any time forward, we can make changes. However, it does go with basically, it creates a withdrawal, a W on a transcript for the main class we're dropping. Obviously, we're moving classes around, to drop Spanish or you know, you need to drop chemistry for some reason, obviously you have to move things around. I'm not going to give you a withdrawal for every class that we have to move around. But there is a penalty, essentially, for not meeting that deadline. But it's something we can talk about. Like, it's something we can work on. Visual Performing Arts, or VPA, 1 year of that for college purposes. Again, the high school graduation is a little bit different. All these classes, again, C or better, and it needs to be the same for each semester. So it doesn't really matter for us, but if you're on a block schedule, it does. Art, ceramics, photo, and all the band classes count for this requirement. Okay, anything additional, so a lot of students will take 4 years of band, for example, or multiple years of art, that's fine. They go, you get 1 year, and the rest of it goes to that college prep elective, and you really only need one of those, and everything else is kind of icing on the cake, and you still add it to your applications, and it still helps you out. The one thing I will note is some students choose to take jazz band, which is the optional kind of morning class, not for credit, and that won't count for this if it's not for credit, but most of those students have already had plenty of years of band for that, really, to matter. And the last category, and then we'll move on and finish, is college prep elective. This is the easiest one. This is any additional course that you've taken from any of the other categories. So that's that extra math class, it's an extra art class, an extra Spanish class. That will all go to fill here, as well as that economics class, which all students have to take and pass. So that's half of a year right there. Plus, you know, there's a physical science general class that does not count towards the lab science, but it will count here, as well as things like AP psychology. Okay? I think that is it for the A through Gs. Any questions about this? And we'll kind of jump into the next part. Okay, cool. If you do have questions that come up throughout the year, don't hesitate to ask, email me, shoot me, you know, make an appointment, we can sit down and talk. So if I asked you to describe this tree, and hopefully this will be a little bit like, I'm really scared about college right now, hopefully this will change some of that and make you a little calmer and less stressed out about college, what we're going to talk about right now. But if you describe a tree, how would you describe it? Like, could you, it's not an aspen tree. I can tell you that. It seems kind of big. Okay, it's probably old or older. And that's about it. I'm not an arborist. I couldn't tell you what kind of tree it is based on the bark. I couldn't tell you if it was infected by beetles, if it got struck by lightning, if it got chopped down. A lot of things I couldn't tell you with this picture. Okay, and this is the picture that when people think about college and applying to college, this is the picture that they see. Okay. And this is kind of the old school way of applying to college. They think of, well, I am my GPA, I am my class rank, and I'm my SAT score. And that's it. Okay. Those are very important things, and those do play a big factor. However, that's not what the vast majority of schools look at. The big system that you are kind of an equation to is the CSU system. Okay, we're not going to jump into the details of it, but you're essentially what's called an academic eligibility index to them, and that's your GPA times your coefficient times your test score, and that's your number. If you meet that campus's number, you probably have a spot. If you don't meet that campus's number, it likely is you don't, and they kind of go from the top down usually. So for the CSU system, that's where it kind of gets a little bit less like personal. You do become a number. However, the CSU system is also designed that many students will get into a CSU. It may not be your CSU of choice. Most students will get into a CSU, though, if you meet the eligibility requirements. It just might not be Cal Poly or Long Beach or something like that. They have different eligibility indexes based on their competitiveness and demand. However, almost all the rest of them, including the UCs and most of the private schools, do what's called comprehensive or holistic review. And this is the Cal Poly way. What holistic review or comprehensive review is this. This is the picture that students kind of present to schools. Okay, schools in the UC system, schools on the Common App, they look at information about the school in general, what AP courses were available, how many did they take that were even offered. So people worry about, well, a school in Reno has 25 AP classes and we only have 13. Are kids at a disadvantage? No. They can't compare us to a school in Reno or a school in Florida or a school in the Bay Area. Like, that's impossible. You can't compare this to that. They do get compared to our students and their classmates. That's the primary comparison about how competitive students are. How many of those AP courses, within reason, and that's a very important denotation, like they call it reasonable rigor. They do not want students that take six AP classes as a senior and don't have any time for any extracurriculars or any volunteer activity or even writing a good essay. Okay, the GPA, the AP courses are important. However, so is all the other stuff. They look at the whole student, the essay that they write, the personal statement, their life experiences, their experience with that volunteer activity or studying abroad or whatever it might be, all plays into their decision. Okay, and it's really about who is the student as a whole, how are they going to come be a good student at our campus, but how are they also going to become a good person to have that we want to be called, you know, a Mustang at Cal Poly or a Bruin at UCLA, whatever it might be. Okay, so they look at all these different things. Within the UC system, they actually break it down. You know, they all get the same application. You can apply to multiple ones, but they all see the same stuff. And each campus sets their own priorities about what's most important to them. One school, they might have a heavy focus on their GPA. Another one, their GPA is going to be at the bottom of their bucket list, and their essay, their personal statement, is going to be what's most important. So, and those are not things that they publish. Those are not things that they say, hey, this is what's most important to us. The faculty decided every single year, and they set their priorities, and they set their numbers that they're trying to meet. And that's what their job is as those readers and as those admissions officers. They're to determine who's the best fit for our campus. Okay, and that's why determining what the best fit is for your student is also important. If your student is not a good fit for a campus, the likelihood of that admissions officer or reader thinking they're a good fit also is pretty small. Okay, so there's two sides of that fit equation. So I hope that doesn't stress you out. It allows students who maybe didn't have the most spectacular academic record, who maybe had an oops here or there, as long as they're eligible, there are other ways that they can be great applicants. Okay, they can make up for a deficient grade with an excellent volunteer opportunity, with an excellent essay many times. Okay, there's an excellent teacher recommendation because they had a great relationship with their teacher, and the teacher said, "Well, you know, we knew that their parents got divorced in their sophomore year, and you know that really affected their grades that year. However, I don't think it affected their overall value as a student." So, they really do look at the whole student. So I want to encourage you guys with that it's not, shouldn't be as stressful as many of us think it might be. But there are a lot of pieces, and we don't have control, and that's kind of scary, and that's the biggest piece. We're not in control of what that looks like. We're going to breeze through some of this stuff. A lot of it we touched on already, okay, but I just want to highlight a few things. The biggest thing for them is continue maintaining those grades. Again, their number one job is being a student. Their number one job is showing up every day. And I can tell you, attendance, if your kid's not attending regularly, that's a big deal. That's the number one indicator not only of students dropping out of high school, but also failing courses. Okay, they have to be here to learn. That's just how school works. So make sure your kids are here and on time. If they show up 5 minutes late to class, many times they might miss a pop quiz. They might miss kind of that review from the day before that really solidifies some of that knowledge. So try to make sure they're here on time. Obviously things happen, things get sick, there's appointments, traffic, construction, all that stuff happens, but do your best. Have them get involved in something. Join a club. And I will, again, join sports. Sports are important. If sports is all they have on their application, unless they're like the worldwide champion in Olympic diving, that's, the people that read these things say, we do not want to read another sports essay in our life. Like, because that's the number one thing that high school students do. They are all pretty much involved in athletics at some point or another. Okay, and many times that's their formative experience. However, many times for some students that's their only experience. Okay, so joining a sport is great, and they should. But they should also have a meaningful experience with a volunteer activity, and consistency is key. They kept on telling us that yesterday. We want to see students involved for more than a couple weeks. We want to see like 2 or 3 years of experience at the PET Network or at this organization where you can go back and really develop a relationship and develop experience. Okay, and that's just valuable experience with them as a student as well. I mean, if you went to a job and worked for 2 weeks and then worked somewhere else for 2 weeks, like you probably wouldn't learn very much about that position. It's a great career exploration activity. You make awesome people that can write you letters of recommendation from outside of the school. So that's just one suggestion. Again, depth, not breadth. So don't try to do 50 things for community service. Try to pick a couple and go more deep with it. All sophomores, unless you opt out, will be taking the PSAT in October. It's October 14th. It's an at-school test. Starts at 7:30, so make sure your student's here. Try to avoid any appointments on that day. it'll be a fairly good test for them to take. So if you do have appointments, try to reschedule. Unfortunately, there are no makeups, and if you're late, you miss out. It's a very strict test.
And what is
a PSAT? We'll talk about that. We'll go through kind of what the specifics. It stands for the preliminary SAT. The SAT is a college entrance test, but it's basically a practice. And they'll have practice tests as a sophomore and as a junior.
But they don't have to sign up or anything.
Nope. October 14th. And all 10th graders and all juniors this year are taking it for free. Okay, so the school's going to pay for it because we think it's important, and it's very valuable to students. So your 10th graders are going to hate it, I can guarantee you. But it's one of the best ways to actually practice for these tests and be successful. It's about 3 hours and 50 minute long test, and they're going to sit and squirm and have to go to the bathroom 20 times. It's kind of fun to watch them as sophomores and watch them as juniors even struggle, but when you're sitting in there, you just watch them and they can't do it. It's just physically impossible for them to sit that long.
And if they don't do that well on it, how much does it affect them later?
Well, it doesn't affect them later. I mean, it's an indicator of how well they do in the future. That's the biggest effect. It's basically a very similar test to what they'll take as an SAT. Just so you know, no one sees the SAT. The only people that see the SAT are us.
But the colleges aren't going to make their decisions based on a PSAT
score? No. PSAT scores, nobody sees it. They don't go to college. They don't go anywhere. However, it's good. It's basically an indicator for us. In 11th grade, the only people that see it are the group called National Merit Scholarship Contest people. And that's only if you're like the 99.9 percentile, meaning you're like perfect score people. So that's very rare. Like every couple years, we get a few people that get like honorable mention, which is good. But that's the only thing that would really matter about it. The big thing is data for us and for you as parents. Okay, this is an indicator of your strengths and weaknesses, and this is also likelihood, if you took the SAT on this date, a pretty good estimate of what you might have done. Okay, I will go quickly over through kind of what the content is, and there are changes happening this year as well. They need to do research of that. College is primarily careers, though. I worked with all 10th graders. I've met with all the classes. They did a Myers-Briggs assessment, where they got some career information, but they also had some homework where they had to go in and do a learning style inventory. We're going to work with them in the next couple weeks about that when I come back into the 10th grade pathways class, but you should ask your child about it. Learning style inventory is probably the most important piece that they did that day because it tells them, and it's a pretty comprehensive result, piece of package of information about like what their best environment is. You guys can set up their environment kind of at home when they study. You know, if it's saying I need a quiet environment, you probably shouldn't have the stereo blaring in your room when you're trying to study. Okay, so using some of that results, it's also good to have the student communicate with the teachers that information if they ever have trouble, saying, you know, I'm really a visual learner, and that's the best way that I take in information. You know, I understand that that's not really your teaching style, but if you could ever incorporate any of those aspects, I would really appreciate it because I think it would help me. So really advocating for themselves, and they can take in that report and just say, hey, you know, this is what it says. Like, what do you think I could do differently in your class? It's a great RTI opportunity. Traveling, if you guys drive around or fly anywhere, try to look up on Google Maps and see what schools are in the area. And go to ones that you've heard of, the big name ones, you know, Berkeley, all these different stuff that are kind of in the news, have great sports teams. Because that's why you heard of them. Did you know that? That's why schools are popular. Because they have great sports teams or they're in great locations. Okay, that's the two big reasons. Not typically because they're academic programs. And even the rankings that you see, like U.S. News and World Report, those are kind of shady as it is, but it also is fairly ranked on how well their sports teams do. So just know when you have those priorities in terms of what school you're going into, unless your student's going to be a Division I athlete, probably doesn't matter if they're like top number one, like Honda, Toyota, Chevy school. Like, there's a lot of schools out there that are probably better for your kid. And then finally, start a planner or a binder if you haven't yet with important information about your student as they go through high school. You're going to want to reference that when you work on applications, when you work on letters or essays for college entrance. And you need to be factual. It's not stuff you can make up. Okay, you can't just say, well, I think I did. Like, I was like captain or something, I don't really know. That will not fly well when they read that interview or that application. So make sure that you're totally factual with what you're doing, but that means you have to remember. This is also some place that all your community service documents should go. You should be making copies of those documents. We here at school are humans. We try not to lose things, but stuff happens. Okay? If we misplace or something drops in the black hole of the backpack of your kid, doesn't make it to their teacher, but they say, oh, but I did 20 hours of community service with this organization. Unless I have documentation, no, you didn't. Or you did for your resume, but not for graduation. Okay, so it's really important. I just suggest either take a picture on your phone, whenever you turn in those things, make a copy. They can come down to the office, ask Ms. Freeman, I just need to make a copy of this before I turn it in. It just double covers us because that's a graduation-tied, board policy-driven requirement that they will not graduate the diploma without 30 hours documented by the time May comes around their senior year. Okay, so that's just something to think about when you're doing that, just kind of a heads up. PSAT, we'll talk quickly about this, and then I promise we're almost finished. The PSAT, again, the practice SAT or preliminary SAT, I always call it practice because no one really uses preliminary anymore. But it's for sophomores and juniors, so they'll both take it together as a group. They take the same exam, and it's October 14th. It does indicate the strengths and weaknesses, and both the PSAT and the SAT exam, you guys don't have to worry about the SATs at this point, but just so you know, they are being redesigned this year. So this is going to be a totally different PSAT than students took last year. Most of the redesigns, and I have a few information there. There was a handout, there wasn't very many of them, so probably not everybody got it. About the differences. Really, for you guys, it doesn't make any difference. You're not going to have any experience with the old SAT or the old PSAT. So it's all a new deal for you guys. So that's really the kind of big changes. So essentially, guys, what you need to know is the big things are there's no penalty for wrong answers. Students should bubble in every single question, where in the old system they actually got a negative quarter point taken off for any incorrect answer, but nothing for a blank answer. So that's a big change. There's a lot more information that's coming straight from their classes in school. Let's see. I have some other pieces of information. It's back to a 1,600-point scale. It used to be on a 2,400-point scale, or it still is, but it's going back to 1,600. And on the SAT, not the PSAT, the SAT, there would be an optional writing component. Okay, just like the ACT, which is its counterpart, a different test, but about hand-in-hand. They have an optional writing. I always suggest students take the optional writing every time they take it, because some schools will require it, other schools won't. If you apply to a school that does and you don't have it, you're kind of up a creek typically. They typically won't take that test. They're doing away with any answers above 5, so it's not like A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, I, you know. It's like 4, you get 4 answers to choose from. It's all multiple choice, except for any writing parts like the essay.
When you do the essay, are you writing on a piece of paper? Or?
Yes. Yeah, so they won't do that on the PSAT, I don't believe. I have to kind of familiarize myself even more with kind of the changes. I'm familiar with the old one. But they should. I don't believe they have it writing an essay on their PSAT, but on the SAT they do write with a pen and pencil, or typically a pen, I believe.
But. And they ought to learn to write in cursive because it's faster.
It's true.
I know. Why we train kids to do that as little kids, and then we make them forget it all. So straight from the College Board, who makes the PSATs, they say the best way to be successful on the SATs, you don't really need to study for the PSATs. It's strictly practice. We want to know where you're at, especially as 10th grade. If you want to study for your 11th grade, that's fine, but it's not really going to help you or hurt you in any way. You do need to prep for the SAT, though, when they start taking it. And typically, students will start kind of halfway through their junior year. So most of them are going to start December, January-ish. On either of those time frames for the real deal SAT in their junior year. And we'll talk about prep stuff next year about that. But really with this new redesign stuff for the PSAT and the SAT, the number one way that you're going to prep, basically on some of these changes they've made, is by understanding what you're learning in class. So it does us a big favor. It makes our learning in class, instead of having to learn these random analogies and this useless information that used to be on the SAT about, you know, we'll just cow has this many feet, like, you know, it's kind of stupid questions that don't make any sense. They're making it much more relevant to what a typical high school student will take in their kind of typically junior and senior years. It's really challenging. It's hard stuff, but it's designed to be more content appropriate and really make their stuff they're learning in high school relevant. So they can't memorize content for a test and then go back and forget it. Like, it's going to appear again and again. And again, the students will take the SAT probably between 3 and 5 times in their junior and senior year. Okay, so it's going to come back. So make sure they're actually learning for the content, not learning for that bubble in, get the grade, and then forget it all. They need to remember. And it grows. There's critical thinking involved in this. I mean, there's a lot of stuff that they're changing. Just quickly, and this will be on the side, we're going to kind of breeze through this. Free SAT prep on Naviance. Again, I don't necessarily think that sophomores should necessarily spend a bunch of time doing SAT prep at this point. However, I did want to make sure that you guys knew it's available, and typically will probably be available next year as well. It is on the old system right now, so it's probably a waste of time for sophomores until they update it at least, which will probably be in mid-spring next year. But I'll remind you guys next year and throughout the year that this is available. Khan Academy also partnered with the College Board, and they offer free SAT prep for that. I believe there is some PSAT prep if they really want to get on there and do that. Through Khan Academy, which is a pretty great program if you haven't used it before. So that's available as well. And we typically try to do an SAT workshop usually in the fall. We're kind of, and that's usually for juniors and seniors, so it's not something that, but just for next year, we have to find someone that's available to do it for a price we can pay. We haven't had one this year because we're missing that person. We talked about the 1-2 already. Community service, reminder. We are going to be a little more strict, slash much more strict on the pre-approval piece, and I told all the students this, and I've told every grade level. Typically, you know, you'll probably kind of get a one-time grace period of, okay, it wasn't pre-approved, get it pre-approved next time, we'll take it this time. Okay, after that, probably after like October, if you haven't turned in community service by October, there's something wrong, probably, but by October, like, if it's not pre-approved, we probably won't take it. You can write it on your resume all you want, but there's a couple different reasons. One, and the big one, is safety. Okay, pre-approval does two things. Pre-approval allows us to pre-approve any activities, so you guys know that you guys get community service counted at the school level for it. So you guys are going to come by and ask either someone in the office. Primarily, you're going to start with your Pathways teacher, but obviously you only meet twice a week with that teacher. However, you can meet them during lunch or RTI to get something pre-approved. But sometimes things come up last minute, you can ask us in the office and we can pre-approve things as well. But that tells you, yes, you're going to get this. The other thing is the parent signature for our side. That tells us that you know what your child is doing. And if your child gets hit on the side of the road doing trash pickup and gets injured and goes to the hospital and needs surgery, you're not going to expect the school to pay for it because of a school function. Like, you knew your child was going outside and doing something that's possibly dangerous. So both knowing what your child's doing, protecting the school a little bit, but also protecting you guys and knowing that you're going to get credit. That's the main reason. Not because we like paperwork, not because we like killing trees. That's why we do that. Okay, and there's some questions that we will be asking students to at least partially complete. I don't expect like an essay on there, but what was your experience doing this? They should answer like a sentence of what was their experience. It's not designed to just go there and forget what you did. Okay, so that's all a part of the packets that they have access in the front that we usually have a big stack of. If we ever run out and students looking for it, just have them ask and we can reprint more. It might not happen that second, but they might have to come back at lunch or the after school, right? And we can get it up for you guys. I'm probably going to skip this. Does anybody have a huge desire that I talk about GPAs?
I just have one question.
Yeah.
I heard that they're calculating several different GPAs now. Is that
true? We've always calculated different GPAs. Okay. So I'll cover that since that might be a question that people have since it maybe piqued their interest. So if you're looking at a transcript, and then just so you guys know, this is a transcript that we can print out at school. This is not something you can print at home. It doesn't look quite like this, but all the information is there. All the stuff you can access through Aries. You can see their credit summary just lives in several different pages of Aries through the parent portal. But what we're asking here is this box where it says it's got three different rows and like three different columns, and on the top it's going to say academic 9-12 academic GPA 10-12 and total GPA 9-12, and then each of these two numbers is weighted, which includes all those AP coursework. Okay, that's where we can get like those 4.0s, 4.2s, that kind of thing, and then on the other side is a non-weighted GPA. So it still counts all the A's, but it throws out the extra points. And most schools will ask for both. They'll want to know a student's non-weighted GPA to know, well, did they get, you know, how was their GPA without all the, you know, bonus points that they may have accumulated, and what was it with it? The top one calculates academic GPA for all 4 years, and academic GPA includes all of their core classes. It basically doesn't include things like PE, engineering, culinary, like learning center, ELD, stuff like that. So it's your non-core academic classes. If you're looking at here, I don't know if it, I can't tell you if it denotes it on the parent side of the transcript, but it's anything, if you can kind of see it underneath culinary arts towards the top left, there's a little asterisk. That denotes a non-academic class that's not included in that calculation. The second one down calculates that same academic GPA, but throws out ninth grade. And that, just so you guys know, that's the GPA that UCs and CSUs will most closely use. They actually recalculate their own GPA. So they don't use what the student enters. The student goes and enters their classes, enters the grade that they get, and then UCs will automatically assign. And the UCs do cap their honors. So they get basically 8 semesters worth of honors or AP credit. And honors doesn't mean our honors English classes. It's their weighted. It's the classes that are weighted. So that includes college and AP coursework. So they get 8 semesters of that weighting. So if they get 8 A's, that's the most they can really get. Anything above that, kind of, it doesn't get included. They do technically get to see their uncapped weighted GPA as well, but that's mainly what they use. And the bottom is their total GPA. That's every single grade they get that's graded on an A through F scale. Doesn't include pass-fail, pass-no-pass classes like pathways. So that was kind of the, in a nutshell, GPA.
So are an A and an A minus both?
Yes, so minus and plus are nothing. Okay. It's basically an indicator. You're almost to a B, you're almost above, you're almost to 100%. So, and really colleges don't care about A minus or pluses either, for the most part. They look at mainly the A, the B, the C, the D. So it's basically more of a measuring tool for us and you guys as parents. So don't get caught up if they got an A minus versus an A. It doesn't affect their GPA any difference, and colleges really don't care that much about it either. Any other questions about that? That's kind of, that's basically it in a nutshell. All right, keep going. We're almost done. We're going to skip Naviance, and I think we are done. Question time. Any other questions that did not maybe get answered that piqued your interest? I know I feel like a water fire hose right now. I always feel
are
like
you telling me that my daughter has all this information?
I did not get, so they did not get all this.
No, no, what I'm trying to get at is they're supposed to be an adult. You know, so I come home tonight and I look her in the face and she says, I know all that. Is that true?
They know some of it. They probably won't know all the intricate details, but they, you know, if you ask them what's an academic GPA versus a total GPA, they probably could.
No, but I mean, I'm just trying to get the general sense that you want to go to Stanford, you want to go to this or that. Uh-huh. Do you know what it takes? And she's going to go, yeah. Does she really know?
I it's hard to say.
So no, but I mean, you've given her the information. Whether she's registered it.
To a certain sense, yes. I don't go through each college and say, this is what it takes to get into Berkeley, this is what it takes to get into MIT, this is what it takes to get into Stanford. And to be honest, like so far, we have not talked tons about college. Like, that's not our focus in 9th and 10th grade. College is not the focus. That's kind of backward shopping, kind of like financial aid. It's backward shopping. When we work with students, we focus on their careers, because that's the end game. You don't go to career to get college. You go to college to get to a career. So we start with the end in mind of, okay, let's look at careers that you might be interested in, because that's going to tell us which might be a good school for you to go to, which might be a major you want to pursue. You might want to go to a school that doesn't even have the major you want to get into. So that's kind of where we start in the 9th and 10th grade year. This year, we kind of start transitioning from the career into more of the college realm of, okay, let's take what we've discovered, what we've thought about, and start doing some more research in terms of, okay, in regards to what we've learned, what is maybe schools I'm going to be looking at? And then as they go into junior and senior year, the junior and senior year is almost all college. So it's almost all, because really at this point, I couldn't tell you if your 10th grader who doesn't even have grades from 10th grade yet is a CSU, is an Ivy League, is a community college bound kid.
No, but all I want to know is, I'm seeing this and it's elevated my heartbeat and I'm going, damn, I better.
No, I don't.
I'm wondering if my daughter has also had that sense like, whoo, or whether it's just like,
whatever.
You know. Some kids, it's like, whatever, I'll learn about this later and I'll deal with this when it kind of hits me in the face. Some kids, they're very worried about it right now. So students do get quite a bit of this information. They don't get this in depth. They can only sit through about 30 minutes of information, and that's if we're lucky, and they don't have their phones out. So we spent about an hour and a half. So you got the much more involved go through each of the different steps. Like we go through the A through G. We talk about some of the entrance requirements. We talk about some of the different systems. We talk about some of the different tests that they're going to need to take. And even still, like ninth graders, that's not something ninth graders need to stress about. If they're worried about college, they're not focused on their classes, and that's going to be their worst thing for them if they're not focused on their classes and thinking about college, and they're kind of working against themselves and going to tank their college because they're stressed out about it. So yeah, there's a specific kind of approach that we take, and we've seen it kind of work for most students. Some students are in a different spot and a little more mature earlier, or mature later. So that's kind of why. So yes and no. She will probably know some of it. Will she be able to spout out intricate details? No. And my goal is not to make them stress and freak out about it. So if I do that, that's not on purpose.
You should be.
Sometimes I do. I got word that I actually, you know, I went over to the eighth grade and I got word from someone I know that I made a kid cry, and I was like, oh man. Not my goal, but it's you know. I try to balance like the important and realistic approach of college is competitive. People are not just going to walk in and hand you a diploma. People are not just going to walk in and hand you a bunch of free money to go to school. Okay, so that kind of realistic and real world approach but you can work to that. And if you're not there, we can get you there if we work hard. Like there are ways to get around it. So we try to use both ends of kind of the stick, the carrot and the stick side, and really balance out that act. So yes and no. They know some of it, not all of it. They probably should be a little bit stressed, but not probably like you are right now. Yes?
Simple question. You mentioned a video that you showed the kids about a line. Is that available on the website?
Yeah. It's not on the website. I can include it in my email when I send out the
That'd
video.
That'd be great.
And it's on YouTube. I wish I could tell you what it's called off the top of my head.
Saw that you showed
yeah.
the 10th graders recently, or?
Did I show the 10th graders? I don't know if I did. That was the juniors. I didn't show the juniors because our tech wasn't working, and they're kind of in a different world.
It has to do with effort?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so I forget what it's called, but it's a kind of like a little motivational, like 10-minute video that kind of goes through kind of what it takes to be successful. And it's pretty good. I'll make a note to include it when
Thank
I
you.
Send out the video link to this recording.
Thanks.
Yeah. Any other questions? If you guys need to go, don't stay. But if you guys want to stay, you can. I'm happy to stay and answer as many questions as I need to. But thank you guys for coming. If you guys
thank
don't
you very
have to
much.
Go, I'm going to stop the video real quick.
Oh, God. How about that?